Evening, evening. Jameson tonight. Another day of transport chassis. Chassis? Oh, chaos. Can't read this bloke. Yes, the disruption of road, rail and all the rest of it. Once again, the poor old public suffers. Hundreds of thousands of innocent people being forced to stay at home and watch Wimbledon on the telly. Isn't it shocking? Let's see what Madam makes of it all. Here she is, the last of the windmill girls, my assistant. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Annabel Giles.
The last of the windmill girls.
In your crown and sceptre.
In my royal gear.
Look at that. You
it's
might get
nice,
the old CMVO yet, you know, if you wear that lot.
Or a Dame Image or something.
Dame Annabel. Can you believe it?
I can see it now.
What are you clutching in
now
your...
Now, this may look like normal popcorn to you, but this is pineapple flavour. And this is pizza flavour. And it's made by Popping Mad. They do 30 flavours, which you can get in the Trocadero Piccadilly. And it's all like, they do everything. They do sort of sweet sour cream and chives and things. Try it, what do you think? This is
we
pizza.
We don't want these American gimmicks here, do we, ladies and gentlemen?
This is quite nice pizza. Derek, please. Ooh. Can I have some of that? You have some of this?
Oh, God.
Try that.
I thought popcorn tasted like popcorn. This tastes like those flavoured crisps.
Yeah, pineapple should taste
Ooh.
Like.
Don't
That's
like
the
it.
Whole point of bringing them on.
Don't like it.
All right, then.
Now then, Annabel.
Yes.
If British Rail increased their pay offer, it's estimated fares will have to rise another 10%. So you better get your second mortgage fixed now, yes?
Right, yes.
London cab drivers are taking lessons in French and German. They're picking up useful phrases like, I'm not going that way. And you don't expect me to change that, do you? It reminds me of a story. This American tourist couple were going to see the Mousetrap. And the fare on the old meter was £5.50, and they gave him a 5p tip, would you believe? And he looked at it, and they didn't know the difference. They thought that was a reasonable tip, 5p on £5.50. And he threw it in the road in disgust, and he said, the butler did it!
Oh, no.
That's true. The former Euro MP, Richard Cottrell, was fined £800 for endangering passengers on an aircraft about to land. Apparently he went round offering people a taste of his in-flight dinner. And Sir Geoffrey Howe, the Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs, says he hasn't given up the chance of becoming party leader. He's just waiting for Screaming Lord Sutch to retire. Yeah? What else you want to know?
I don't know. What else, Derek? Tell us all.
We've got to get on with the show, haven't we, eh? The biggest surprise in showbiz history, I reckon, has been the astonishing success of that Australian soap opera on Britain's airwaves, Neighbours. The fever has gripped the nation. Kylie and Jason are the pop idols of today. What can it all mean? We'll ask Jim. He's been in the show from the start, and indeed, his father figure of Neighbours. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to have with us tonight, welcome Alan Dale. Now then, Alan, bloody Australians are taking over the world.
Not bad at cricket, too.
Oh. We seriously, genuinely thought we were going to hammer you in this test.
Yes, I know.
Every year, we always assume we're going to win. Never the same with the tennis, you know. They get all excited about the British players. They're not even in the top 100, are they? But why is Neighbours such a success, Alan?
Oh, look, that's a question that everyone asks. Whoever knows the answer to that question could be a multimillionaire.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess it's sunny, it's bright, it's humorous. You know, I don't
is it as big at home in Oz?
Well, often the easy answer to that is no, but it is really, to be honest, the same percentage of people watch it. But we're not so unique there, you see.
Ah, indeed.
So we're Australians in Australia, so.
And you think that gives it an edge over EastEnders and Coronation Street?
Well, I watched Coronation Street all the way through from the beginning in New Zealand, where I grew up, and. I, I, I think Coronation Street's got the humour, but I think the East End is a wee bit sort of dour.
I cover the East End, and of course I watch Coronation Street, because I don't recognise the East End in that. They don't laugh, do they?
That's what I mean.
Whoever heard of Cockneys being together for 5 minutes and not having a laugh? Yeah. If it's only at someone else's expense. Preferably at someone else's expense. No, but Coronation Street is the ultimate, isn't it, Alan?
That's great.
That's wonderful. Bette Lynch, I'd die for her, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you, seriously? Yeah. That Alec Gilroy, the way he's treated her, is outrageous. Big fat git. Who the hell do you think he is? It's true, isn't it? Never mind, Bette. But we were talking about Neighbours. Tell me, Jason and Kylie may never have been heard of because it was almost a disaster, wasn't it?
Yeah, in fact, yeah, what it was.
It was switched channels.
Well, it got canned. It was
canned
out.
By number 10.
Yeah, by 7.
7. Who owned that?
Back in those days, it was a family called Fairfax.
Oh, the Fairfax.
Mm.
Yes, they owned lots of newspapers.
They used to.
Because the Sun and Air took over. Mm.
Yes, that's another story. They're making a movie about that too.
And then, who owns 10?
It's a chap called Lowy.
Not a chap called Murdoch.
Well, I don't
know. What a clever man. That's Randolph Murdoch. Fantastic.
Did it?
Well, really, yes.
Sir.
Yes, he's sir to all of us, really, because he's the boss here. Well, he doesn't own as much of it as he used to.
So it changed channels and, of course, was headed for down the tube and suddenly picked up again in Australia.
Yes, it did.
And how many years ahead are you in Australia compared with here?
18 months ahead.
18 months.
It's not too bad, actually.
So has the cast totally changed?
No, in fact, the cast that was there 18 months ago, pretty well the same as, for Kylie and Jason.
Kylie and Jason. Yeah. Have they gone?
Yes, they have.
And that's why they're always hanging about Shepherd's Bush in London.
Yeah. They've got time on their hands, you see.
A great thought has come into my tired old brain. Why don't we start a series based on Australian exiles in Earl's Court, West London, with Jason and Kylie heading the cast list? You can come and play as well.
Great.
It'd be knockout, wouldn't it? And then not only would it conquer the airwaves in Britain, we could flog it to the Australians.
Yeah? We've been buying your stuff for years.
Now then, look here. What's this? Private Lives of the Stars of Neighbours?
Oh.
1, 2, 3, 4. You've got that out there, Aylesbury. Thick he is, the director. He's very slow. I have to hold it up. This is... Oh, here we go. Now, this is yours, Alan, this publication. Exclusive.
Well, yeah. It's ours, yeah.
Is it shock horror drama?
No.
What do you mean, then? You've got private lives. I thought it was going to be full of scandal.
Well, the point that people miss is that we're just suburban people who do a job in Melbourne. I mean, Melbourne's a very quiet place in the world and we have a very quiet life. And, I mean, no matter what the press tries to sort of to say about us, that we're very ordinary folk.
Take pity on us. We try to jazz it up a bit.
Thanks,
do you get fed up with the way the British press treats Neighbours?
I get a bit tired. Not too much. Like, I like the way that they're positive about it, but when they're negative, they're really, they're wrong virtually every time. Every time I say something bad, virtually every time it's wrong.
What you mean, Alan Dale, is that when they say good things, it's great. But when they're knocking and saying nasty things, it's dreadful.
It would be all right if they were right. That's all, Derek.
Indeed.
Not being too
We in this country, we don't expect them to be right as well, you know.
Don't you?
No. I don't. Most people, if you ask them, what do you think of your newspaper? I mean, I was 40 years in Fleet Street, and I always said, what do you think of my newspaper? And for 40 years, they always answered one word, and I can guarantee the audience will answer it without me priming them. What do you think of your newspaper?
Rubbish!
That's the word.
Rubbish,
always. Yeah, they've got a very healthy disrespect for the British press. Annabelle, you take Annabelle. You love our press, don't you, Annabelle?
I loathe them.
There you are. Look here.
I hate
change the subject quick.
Awful.
They only paid peanuts for you lot in Neighbours. Is it true you worked 5 shows for $400? 200 quid?
No, guys, we're from one extreme to the other. Other stories are about the fact that I'm the highest paid actor that ever lived. So, no, look, they're inaccurate. Both ends of the scale. We looked after very nicely.
Is that right? But in the early days, I suppose.
It was a bit tough, but in those days, they were trying to amortise the cost of putting the show together, and it wasn't, at the time, there was no way that anyone would imagine that Coronation Street Australian style would take the world by storm as it has.
Is it true you're engaged to Miss Australia?
Oh.
Yeah. Are you married?
Just talk amongst yourselves for a little bit.
He's engaged to Miss Australia, you know. Or she was, the former Miss Australia.
Yes, that's right.
They're not married. Why are you getting married?
That's another story. That's my private life, Derek.
Oh, come on. How can you have a private life?
Because it's private. That's why it's called a private life, isn't it? Because
yes.
It's private.
Is it in here, Alan? Private lives?
No, because I wrote that a year ago before.
Is she here with you, your girlfriend?
What a coincidence, no.
What a shame. I was looking for her up in the concert.
No, she's not here.
She's back in Oz, is she?
Yes, she is.
Are you on a state visit, then?
Yes, absolutely.
The BBC looking after you?
No, this is private. We're here to talk about this magazine, and because it was released last year, but it sold out so quickly no one had a chance to buy it, and so we re-released it. And,
did I hold it up?
Yes, you did.
Alan, play your cards
right. It's called Private Lives.
Play your cards right. Come to me for advice. I can get you 100 grand for this in Fleet Street. They are desperate for anything at all about neighbours.
We've been having discussions, yes.
We're
part of your family.
You already know that. And have you married on screen? If you haven't married Miss Australia off screen, what about on screen?
Yes,
are you
married now? Yes, I am now married, yes.
Do you marry Beverly?
I do.
Oh, he married Beverly. We knew he would, didn't we?
Yeah,
we knew he would.
She's sweet, isn't she?
Checking if
she's English.
Is she?
English Rose.
In real life or on the screen?
Really, in real life. She's a pom.
A lot of them are of pom origin, aren't they? Well, I suppose most of Australia are poms. They all went over there with the old fetters on, didn't they?
A lot of Irish there, I think.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. And of course, the East Europeans now.
Yes.
But neighbours is very much the Anglo side of Australia.
It is, really. I sometimes wonder about that myself, whether it wouldn't be nicer to have a bit more of the multicultural lifestyle in it. But we're not there to educate, we're there to entertain.
No. Well, if you've not got any scandal, shock, horror, drama for me, Alan, we'll just have to wish you well and say good day to you. Good day, good day.
Good day, mate.
Good day in Britain means goodbye, isn't it? We say that at the end of a conversation, good day. Annabelle, she comes from the upper classes.
She knows about it. Good day, Derek.
Good day.
Yes, no, I don't think we did.
So, will it go on forever, Al?
Well, I mean, Coronation Street has.
Jim Boy. Will it go on forever? Neighbours, do you reckon?
I don't know.
Are you willing to stay with it to the end? Because you're a pioneer, one of the first.
Every day is another day.
A challenge. Mm. Well, we wish you well. It's been a great success. And we love Australians, really, don't we?
Especially
fiendish, diabolical booze they sell. Good luck. Alan Dell, thanks very much for coming in, sir. Great. Now, to be serious for a moment, I think we were all saddened by the death of Kay Kent. That was the girl who modelled herself on Marilyn Monroe, and we have the inside story on that tragedy after this break.
Tomorrow, the Sail of the Century champ goes for the top prize.
It's fingers and toes crossed for the champ. Oh, this is the big one.
Tomorrow on Sky Channel.
Tomatoes to a traditional recipe. No wonder there's no taste like Heinz.
Soft. Like pudding.
My mum's swimming suit.
They're still trying to describe a totally new kind of softness.
Little baby ducks like yellow.
Well, I think it smells like sky to me.
The special softness you get with new Lenore.
Breastfeed again.
Some. Ghost.
Only Lenore can make your wash almost too soft for words.
Mark and Sue have never taken good health for granted. To be sure of private health care, they became members of Bupa. This priority was brought home to them recently when Sue fell ill. She was treated in a Bupa hospital where her problem was diagnosed with a body scanner. You see, Bupa have priorities too. No one takes a profit. Anything left over from caring for their members today is reinvested for their future, like hospitals, health screening centers, and the latest medical technology. Most people choosing private health care join Bupa. Bupa. Britain feels better for it.
newt and toe of frog.
We've a bat and tongue of dog.
And 3 spoons of sweetener.
That'll taste disgust.
Some sweeteners won't cook at high temperatures, but Sweetex uses NatriBlend, so all your cooking tastes wonderful.
Still needs a little something.
Sweetex. Now you can have your cake and eat it.
Hi, I'm Pat Sharp of the Nescafe UK Top 50, the fastest moving chart show around. Join me and all the stars out and about every Saturday at 4 o'clock sharp.
Hi, I'm Jim Kerr from Simple Minds.
Hi, this is Wendy from Transvision Vamp.
Hi, this is Tina Turner, and you're watching my favourite...
Nescafe.
UK Top 50.
And Europe's number one
star. Bam, boom! Three. Stay streets ahead of the rest on the Nescafe UK Top 50 every Saturday at 4.
Hello again. I was talking about model Kay Kent, the Marilyn Monroe lookalike, who, of course, took her life in Chatham, Kent, in much the same way that her heroine died in Hollywood. She was found naked after taking an overdose. Well, until they split, Kay's long-standing boyfriend was a local rock musician. He's with us now with his new girlfriend. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Dean Hammond and Rebecca Smythe. Dean, I'm glad you came on, because ever since that terrible tragedy, I've wondered, you know, why did it happen? Because Kay, she was 24, she looked more like Marilyn than the others, didn't she? And she was earning, what, over £1,000 a week. So why did she take her life?
Well, I don't really know, to be honest, right, but this is what I feel. She was upset about her mother dying. But she already accepted her mum as being dead when she wasn't dead, because she was so ill with cancer.
Yeah.
But the time her mum had died, she more or less accepted it. So she carried on working, and she seemed happy enough, you know. But how can I say it?
Did she have problems, do you think, in her head? Was she?
Well, she was upset, but what it was is, I've been with her for so long that I was always dependent on her, so she always looked out for me.
How long were you together? 9 years, was it?
9 years, yeah. All it was is our relationship become an habit, and one of us needed to split it up, but none of us could ever do it. But we raired all the time, see?
So it was a fight all the time, you were fighting?
Yeah, it was like that all the time, see, because all it was is she was concerned about me because her career was going up and mine never even got off the ground, you know?
What do you do, actually, yourself, Dean?
I sing.
Sing?
Yeah,
sing.
And dance.
And were you getting gigs locally in the Medway?
Oh, I've done it for years. It's just that she seemed to be in the right place at the right time and that sort of thing, but...
And, of course, she had this uncanny likeness to Marilyn, didn't she? She really was like her.
Yeah, I never really took much notice of it, to be honest.
Is that right?
Because I was used... I met Kay when she had dark hair and... And Kay was just Kay to me, my girlfriend, you know what I mean? Yeah. When she came in, we'd have another row.
Why, was she totally obsessed by Marilyn Monroe?
Nah, rubbish.
Really? So it was just a job, really?
Just a job, yeah, you know.
Because the papers implied that her whole life was Marilyn Monroe, that she had hundreds of pictures and she modelled herself on her.
Yeah, she modelled herself on her because that was her job.
But it didn't become an obsession that drove her potty?
No.
So it wasn't that, it wasn't really copying Marilyn Monroe at all.
Kay was like one of the lads, you know what I mean? She's just, you know, she wasn't like everybody thought. You know, people were scared to even talk to her because of what she looked like, but she'd talk to anybody, you know, it's just appearance, isn't it, you know?
And so you don't think that when she, you know, took the overdose, she was trying to do a Marilyn Monroe at all?
No, what it was, the reason I felt was she was grieving her mum. Over her mum dying, so she knew what it felt to feel that way. Mm. She must have thought, but if she died, I'd feel that way. But when she discovered that I didn't need her, which I found I didn't anymore, I wanted to do my own thing, and her relationship was so bad, I thought I was doing the right thing, to be the truth. She was so unhappy about me going down the hill and her climbing the ladder. We read about so much. I thought I'd get out of her life so she can be happy because she was unhappy with the way things were going for me. So I had to do it. So I done it and I moved away. And in that time I moved away, I bumped into her.
This Rebecca, Rebecca here. Mm. Of course, he says, how old are you, Rebecca?
16.
You're a big girl for 16, eh?
That's what I thought.
Are you still at school?
Just left last Thursday.
Just left, yeah. So you formed a relationship with Rebecca, you fell in love. And did Kay resent that?
She didn't know.
Oh, so she never knew anything about
it anyway? She never knew, because when I finished the relationship, I didn't have the guts to tell her why I was finishing it. I was finishing it because the reason I said I was finishing it, but I met her. But she gave me the strength to do it, because I don't know if I'd met her, if I really would have carried it through. It would have been another, bumping into each other again. I'll come back and here we go again.
So, here's a question for you, Dean. Had you gone back, do you think she'd have still been there now? Or do you think she would have still gone ahead?
She might have done it a bit later on in life.
Listen, somewhere in all of this, I can see the demon booze. Was there a lot of drinking going on?
No. See, with Kay, right, she was happy and all, happy-go-lucky girl and that. She used to have a laugh. She's so witty. You say any conversation, she'd always have something funny she threw in, you know, and you'd always go, oh. You know, she was so clever. But with the drink, once she drank a lot of vodka, if she felt like it, she'd get bad-tempered or she'd get blues, she'd be down.
Right.
And I think maybe taking that drink that night, you know, made her down, things were even more down for her because she was...
So the night she died, she must have been drinking.
Oh, well, they said that, I don't know. They said there was a bottle of vodka and some pills. I don't know how she done it, to be honest, you know, because that's only what I was told, because I haven't seen her.
Rebecca, have you taken some stick in Chatham as a result of all of this?
Terrible, especially at school.
Really?
Yeah.
What happened?
I went into school Thursday because it was my last exam, and there was all young kids running up to me, calling me the Marilyn Monroe murderer and asking if I like murdering people and things.
Oh.
I just didn't know what to do. I just burst out crying because, you know.
And you never even knew Kay? You'd never met her?
Oh, you should do.
Well, I'd seen her, but I hadn't really spoke to her. I didn't know her as a person, but I heard from everyone that, you know, she was a really nice girl. And you know.
Of course, they say there's nothing so cruel as children, don't they?
Yeah.
And they were blaming you.
Yeah.
So what do you think about that, Dean? Not fair.
No, they don't know, see, because I told her they're not doing it because they think you killed Marilyn Monroe or Kay Kent or anybody. They're just doing it because the kids are a bit jealous of the attention. You know, is that a word? When you know what she's getting in the papers, and because I've been getting that sort of blokes, you know, people bumping into me saying I started this, I started that, and people I know I go right to, and then they go right like that, and I think, you know, what I mean, they didn't know her, they didn't even talk to Kay when we was together, you know what I mean, and then all of a sudden they got to stick their oar in.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
So how do you feel now? I mean, it looks like she got depressed. Her mother had died of cancer. You'd left her. She's on her own there, knocking back the vodka, on the pills, and now she killed herself. Where does that leave you? Will you carry that around with you all your life, or can you shake it off?
I cry all the time.
I bet you do, Yeah, I thought so. Do you feel that some way responsible, you know, that if only you'd have been near, you could have saved her?
Yeah, I suppose so. If I turned up, I might have said, all right, put that down, blah, blah, blah. But she might have done it again another time, you know.
So Rebecca's going to sort you out now.
Yeah.
Got another strong woman there. How are you, Rebecca? You've got a career coming on, haven't you?
Yeah.
Because by a strange coincidence, you've been on that Sky Star Search.
Yeah.
Yeah. Were you proud of her there, Dean? No?
Yeah, well, she's brilliant.
Yeah? So when are you getting married?
Hey, who are you talking to?
Married? I'll get famous first then.
Yes? Yeah. You're going to chase the fame game?
Yeah.
Well, look after yourselves and don't. No more tragedies, eh, Dean? Put it all behind you now. Yes? Ladies and gentlemen, wish you well. Dean Hammond and Rebecca Smyth. We have Cowboy Joe, a country and western singer, who's also a bingo caller, after this break.
Weekday afternoons, join our top lineup of daytime drama on Sky Channel. Starting at 12 o'clock with a Sky favorite, Another World. Then at 12:55, it's time to visit the patients and staff of General Hospital. That's followed by another popular series, As the World Turns. Lastly, at 2:45, stay tuned for the feuding families of Loving. Daytime drama, weekday afternoons on Sky Channel.
His first time alone at the dentist. My teeth were weak, but his should be stronger.
Is your children's tooth enamel strong enough to fight decay? Imagine their tooth enamel is like a wall. Some areas are more prone to decay. But now a new enamel in Formula Crest has been developed especially to strengthen tooth enamel against decay.
No fillings.
New enamel in Formula Crest. A stronger wall against decay.
Lick your lips.
Pick and mix.
Get your kicks.
Pick and mix.
Yo! Raspberry Ritz.
Pick and mix.
Stretch your mitts.
Pick and mix.
Ha! See what clicks? Monster mix. Lucky dips. Get to grips.
There's no pick and mix like Woolworth's new pick and mix.
Yeah.
There, we've been asked to test a new formula washing powder, so we've got all these washing experts in from Watford, led by Angela. Now, sorry, I said a new washing powder, but that's Bold.
Yes, but it's new Bold, and we've made it even softer. So now Bold not only gets clothes beautifully clean, it gets them wonderfully soft too. Bold's the only leading washing powder that does both. That's its built-in bonus.
Really soft?
Yes.
Really, really soft? So yes. If I put a towel washed in Bold, it was some towels washed in other leading powders, Angela there could easily tell the difference.
Yes.
Ha-ha! Well, if Angela can't feel your built-in bonus, you really dropped yourself in it, haven't you? OK, Angela, right, you're the expert now. What about these towels?
They all look lovely and bright and clean.
Yes, OK, but are they soft? What about softness? Which one is softer than the others? Have a feel. Is the one...
This one over here.
Yeah! It's Bold! Angela, come on, honestly, did it feel that different?
So much different. I was amazed. Really soft and bouncy and fluffy. Very, very different. I wasn't expecting it to be so different at all.
Well, it looks like Bold really is an extra good deal. Right, ladies? Why buy a detergent that stops at cleaning? Softness is
Bold's Filthy Water!
Tomorrow, the Sale of the Century champ goes for the top prize.
It's fingers and toes crossed for the champ. Oh, this is the big one.
Tomorrow on Sky Channel.
Watching Jameson Tonight, the sophisticated late-night chat show on Sky Television. What a load of rubbish. Are you all right, Annabelle?
I'm fine, thank you, Derek.
What's next on the menu, then?
It's a cowboy-type person.
Indeed,
chat,
a gun-slinging country and western singer from Norwich who earns his living as a bingo caller. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Marshal Pete Wood. Hi, Pete. Good to see you. As I live and breathe, it's Howard Keel, isn't it? Hey, you look like Howard Keel.
Do I?
Yeah. Is that a compliment or an insult?
It's a compliment. It's a compliment. Oh,
he seems a decent enough chap, doesn't he? Wasn't he in Dynasty or Dallas?
Dallas, I think, yeah.
But really, you and I know him from a 101 cowboy film.
Yes, indeed, yeah.
What turned you on to the Western mode of life?
Well, I was always a cowboy from the days of the Saturday morning picture shows, you know, when I was seven.
I said it was Gene Autry.
Roy Rogers, Gene Autry, and Hopalong Cassidy, true. Yeah.
Do you remember Tonto? Wasn't he lovely, that Tonto?
Yeah, he was great, wasn't he?
The
Red
Indian guide, mentor, friend. Annabelle's just pulling faces.
No, I'm too young, Dick.
Too early for you.
Wayne, I can remember.
Before your time.
Well, John Wayne was around
there. He was a cowboy.
In fact, a lot of people don't realise that Gene Autry and Roy Rogers are still alive, you know, I mean, from
Matt
the days
Trigger.
Of...
Yeah.
Trigger's dead, he's stuffed.
Oh, bless him.
Get stuffed, Trigger. Tell me, is the Marshal a sort of Sheriff Marshal? Is that part of your name?
No, it is my stage name.
I see.
Marshal Pete Wood, which I when I go out in Canberra, it's that is a name I use.
And does your showbiz career as a singing cowboy get in the way of the bingo?
No, because all I actually do, as far as the bingo is concerned, is actually call 6 afternoons a week for about 2 hours.
In Norwich?
In Norwich, yeah. I live right next door to the bingo hall, and in the winter, when things are pretty tough,
quiet.
You know, you've got to have a day job.
Yeah, indeed.
I've called there for about 10 years, you know, which is... everyone knows me as a bingo caller and not as an entertainer.
Have you got some members of the club here in the audience?
Well, there's a rabble somewhere, I think.
Hello, rabble.
Hands up to bingo from Norwich. Yeah. Ah, yes, welcome, welcome. Any wins lately? Any biggins? Because they've got that big computerised
national
game, haven't they? Oh,
yes, £50,000 a night.
Has anyone ever won in Norwich?
Oh, yes, quite frequently.
Really?
Yeah.
I turned that on, you know. I was the one who had to press the button.
Did you? Oh, of course you did, yes. Yeah, I remember.
Indeed. I thought, I wish they'd tell me how to win it. I'm not worried about pressing the old button.
I only came down with them because they gave me a free lift.
Now, what made you, you know, there you were watching the Saturday morning films, and then from there, did you ever go to America yourself?
No, I didn't. I didn't think the necessity was there, really, because, you know, America bought... everyone wants to be a cowboy today usually wants to be the Hollywood cowboy, and, of course, Hollywood bought the cowboys to England, and in the form of the movies. And I don't think anyone wants to be a real cowboy. I think what we want to be is the Roy Rogers, Clint Eastwoods and the John Waynes, which, of course, is all there.
And it's very flourishing in this country, isn't it? I mean, there are clubs.
There are clubs all over the place, yeah.
And the more further north you go, the more there are.
Yeah, and it's a good way to get out aggression. I mean, if you have a shootout, and I mean, I've had... In 1973, I shot off for the Eastern Championships, and it was great fun because I mean, I
that was
I did
pistol shooting.
Yeah, six
on
six
a range.
Years, yeah.
On a range.
Yeah. No. This is just straightforward blank shooting against a balloon and a time machine, which tells you how quick you can draw the gun from.
So the competition is how quick.
Is how quick? Yeah, I mean, I think if we went back to real times, I mean, it would be a question of how willing you are to kill, which of course would be.
Have you got your guns there?
I have. Yeah.
Really?
This is the real thing. This
really?
Is the, yeah.
Hey, come on then, Pete. Give us a demonstration of how quick you can pull them out.
Well, it's a question. I think really.
I'll be the target. No, Annabelle.
Right.
Annabelle.
No, Derek will be the
Annabelle
target.
Annabelle will be the target. Eva, they got one, Pete. I thought they had two, didn't they?
Well, I've got four, actually, but I didn't think you wanted them. The thing is, you've got to tie your holster down, which is most important.
Oh, thank goodness you said holster. I wonder
and,
what you meant.
You know, it's a cocking action, which means you've got to, you've actually got to cock the gun right back as far as it can go before it fires. I won't fire it because... can you move
it? We don't want to kill you.
I'll just do what I call a Gene Autry and Roy Rogers spin, which is, it weighs about 2.5 pounds, and it...
Do you want a ready, steady go?
Whoa. Gosh.
That's the Lone Ranger back in there, and then you just go... And that's it.
Wow. Fantastic. Feel the weight of that.
Oh, yes,
Annabelle?
Please do. Would you like to handle my weapon, madam? Yes. Would you like to handle the other one? Oh, I haven't got it with me.
We get them all on late night television Sky.
It's really heavy.
I tell you what fascinates me about you, Pete, is your brother Charles.
My eldest brother Charles.
He's your eldest brother. How many in the family?
I've got two brothers. One's a university lecturer at Sunderland University.
Oh.
And Charles is... I suppose, really, the guy who wrote Tumbledown.
That's right. Charles Wood, of course, wrote Tumbledown, that controversial play about the Falklands War.
My mum and dad were in show business. I was born in show business. You know,
I'd say it's a showbiz family.
Yeah, my mum was with Brian Ricks at the Whitehall in Dry Rot, and dad was a theatre producer, manager, and...
Yeah. And what about brother Charlie, the distinguished playwright? What does he think about his little brother being a cowboy singer?
Well, I think when they ask him, about his family, he turns around and he says that he has two brothers. One's a cowboy and the other one is totally mad, which more or less figures it out, because Patrick is a bit... he's a university professor, I think, he's a bit crazy.
Well, it's certainly a wild and wonderful family, that's for sure. And of course, we've overlooked the most important, your singing prowess, my dear.
Oh, yes.
Because apart from the old pistols and the bingo, you also are a mean country and western singer.
Well, I do
so
a bit.
Will you sing for us tonight?
I'd love to, yeah.
Marshall Pete, what are you going to give us?
Rawhide.
Oh, why not? Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, nice, all the way from Norwich, Marshall Pete Wood with Rawhide. Yeah.
rolling, rolling, rolling. Though the streams are swollen, keep them doggies rolling raw high. Rain and wind and weather, hell bent for leather, wishing my gal was by my side. All the things I'm missing, good fiddles, love and kissing, waiting at the end of my ride. Eat 'em up, move 'em on, move 'em on, eat 'em up, move 'em on raw high. Cut 'em out, ride 'em in, ride 'em in, cut 'em out, cut 'em out. Ride 'em in raw high. Yeah. Move them on raw high. Cut them out, ride them in, ride them in, cut them out, cut them out. Ride them in raw high. Yeah! Rolling, rolling, rolling. Oh, the streams are swollen. Keep them doggies rolling raw high. Through rain and wind and weather, hell bent for leather, wishing my gal was by my side. Ride 'em in raw high. Raw high. Raw high.
Well done.
Marvellous.
Great, eh? Music and laughter next. We have comedian Lucy Graffo and the group Waterfront after this break.
Friday on Sky Channel, the mega powers explode in WrestleMania 5.
That'll never shift. It's ground in.
No. I'll zap it with the aerial liquid.
No, Sharon. Liquid for dishes.
Powder for clothes.
Girls, these char agencies send one.
It's dead easy. Squidge some on the stain. Then fill the thingy and bung it in the machine.
She's washing Hugo's best polo shirt in lukewarm water with a plastic ball. And I'm getting one of my headaches.
It gets stuck in straight away, right at the heart of the wash. There you go. Cleaner than a joke on children's hour. The lot.
Aerial liquid. Sounds crazy, but it cleans to the heart of the wash.
It's staggering.
No, it's just sitting there.
I'll tell you what I think about bringing up children. You don't need old-fashioned discipline. You have to give them love and earn their respect. And my daughter, no problems about drugs, anything like that. Well, I know they never tell the parents, but I am pretty sure, really. A boyfriend, nice young man. Thing is, he previously been with another girl ages before, and as it turned out, she had, you know, taken drugs. And well, the way I see it is, if that girl had been helped in time, my girl wouldn't have got AIDS. Thank you.
first time alone at the dentist. My teeth were weak, but his should be stronger.
Is your children's tooth enamel strong enough to fight decay? Imagine their tooth enamel is like a wall. Some areas are more prone to decay. But now a new enamelin formula crest has been developed especially to strengthen tooth enamel against decay.
No fillings.
New enamelin formula crest. A stronger wall against decay.
Out now, TV Guide, featuring Brookside's Billy Corkill, Bad Boy Made Good. Superstar Michael J. Fox talks about life, love, and success. The legend lives on. James Dean captured in a photo special. From Hollywood heartthrobs to roving reporters, TV Guide investigates the real-life dangers faced by foreign correspondents, plus the only comprehensive weekly guide to satellite TV, highlighting the best on the box. TV Guide, out now.
Hello again. Well, there's a lovely village in Lincolnshire called Boothby Graffo. And this bloke has pinched its name. What a rascal. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome comedian by the aforementioned Boothby Graffo.
Get a bit of that. I've just been to Wimbledon to see the cricket. Well, there's bugger all gone out Lords. This is the English cricket team. Don't laugh, just concentrate on breathing. In, out, you'll get there. Try this one. This is Gerry Adams on the television. The government ban worked, we haven't heard from him since. And this is the Italian traffic jam. The end of the Waltons. And now, no, please, at the bar, don't clap, they'll throw you a fish. Now, a very difficult one. Try and imagine this is a dark and dingy, common English day. You don't hear many English jokes, unless you go to Northern Ireland, you hear quite a few. So try and imagine this is a dark English day, and there's no sunshine, you are going to be the sunshine. So when I say three, you shout sun. One, two, three. Sun. This is what happens to an Englishman when the sun comes out. Just imagine this is a street. Sometimes they have tables, and Derek Jameson happens to be just in the street at the same time. He's looking for work on another channel. Right, here we go. Englishman walking down the street. One, two, three.
Sun.
I'm a brown, yeah? I'm a brown. Why do English people want to be brown? They want to go to South Africa and not have to vote. That's why. I've just been to see a new film. It's the most successful war movie ever made. It's cram-packed full of sex, blood, death, excitement, and adventure and high-speed camera chases. It's called Kate A.D. Goes Shopping. It's wonderful. After 7,000 people were slaughtered in cold blood in Tiananmen Square, Mrs. Thatcher stood up in the House of Commons and condemned it. That put the wind up Deng Xiaoping. It frightened him so much, he's now shooting students one at a time and hoping that no one will notice. Marvellous, Deng Xiao, well done. 7,000 people are murdered. It brings out harsh words. When 500 hippies organise a day trip to Stonehenge, it brings out everything but a Polaris missile. 800 police and 2 helicopters for 500 hippies. What do they need helicopters for? How high do these hippies get? I mean, it doesn't happen. Thank you. Yes, I preferred the other intro as well. Get off. But no, 800 police for 500 hippies. My granny could take on 500 hippies. But now she's involved in wrinkly armed robbery. She's filed the number off a Zimmer frame and she's knitted her own full-face balaclava. The sleeves are a bit long, but she looks wonderful. Try this very quickly. Don't know how long we've got. Keep going, kid, okay? This is your deodorant. It's got directions on it. Directions on deodorant strike me about as much use as bulletproof leg warmers to a Palestinian, but they're on here anyway. Here's a very quick one. Back there, good. Right, try this one. The directions are shake well. Hold 6 inches from the underarm and spray. Do not spray it near a naked flame. That's why flies don't smoke. Thanks a lot. Cheers. Go on.
Boothby Graffo. We'll be hearing a lot more of him unless the police get to him first. And it's time for tonight's pop video, Boothby. Here it is, the great sound of Waterfront with their latest number, Cry!
Please don't apologize, just let me wipe the tears away. I don't mean to act surprised, if it's all right, I
got Chris and Phil here from Crank. Now, chaps, I've got to ask the most obvious question. You know who it's going to be?
Sorry?
Do you know what I'm going to ask the most obvious question? Has anyone ever mentioned you? That sounds a little bit like George Michael.
Well, the stock answer to that is I'm very good friends with George, actually, and I played it to him about 8 months ago.
Right.
And he thought it was great and didn't see a similarity. But it was top 10 in America last week, so who am I to worry about it?
Now, this is the thing. It was top 10 in America, but it's been in our charts for weeks, hasn't it, Phil? Why? Tell us why. What's the secret?
I think it's down to radio stations in America. There's hundreds of radio stations.
Do you think? They play it, so they play it more so much.
They love it over there. They love it. They love it here, too. You like that song,
don't
you?
We love that.
Yes, there you go.
We love that,
But you're huge in Italy, aren't you?
You're pretty huge here, really, too.
I knew it. I'm so sorry. Well, you're very successful in Italy.
Yeah, we're doing all right in Italy. We did a festival last week called Festival Bar, which was held in Naples. And basically what they do is they set up a stage in the middle of Naples, and everybody in the whole of Naples turns up, and it's just absolutely chaos, anarchy, and just it's just mad.
What was it about grabbing a girlie from the front and pulling onto the stage?
Grabbing a girlie from the front. Well, actually, no. I pulled. There's a sax solo in the middle of the song "Cry," and we didn't have a sax player on stage. So you know, rather than being stood to attention, thinking of the Queen for 30 seconds or whatever. I just motioned to a girl at the front who was in a stunning red dress, and I said, you know, come up here. She says, well, you should come down here. You know, so I sort of leapt off the stage because the sax solo is not that long, guys, and I got to move quickly. And pulled her up onto stage, and we just had a dance. It was really good.
Did she look like a Frankfurter? Because I tend to in tight red
dresses. No, but she had some wonderful bananas on her dress. It was very nice.
Oh, well, that's a relief. I'm glad we got that sorted out.
Yes.
You turned down a Debbie Gibson tour, didn't you?
We did.
That was a shame. Why did you do that?
You tell me.
Because you're a little bit MOR. But your writing is very good, isn't it? I mean, you're known for your writing as well. And you tend to write for all sorts of MOR types, like Randy Crawford and Sheena Easton,
Pepsi
and Shirley.
We try and do our bit,
But why?
Pays the rent.
For the money.
No,
actually, you know, it's good because we were signed as songwriters before we got the deal. And it's sort of, in our spare time, it keeps us occupied, you know. And it doesn't, you know, pleases the bank manager
well. There is that one. And very quickly, you told me you had to turn down Walt Disney.
We've just turned down...
It's a shame.
The part to write the music for a new Disney film, because we're making a video this week that's very steamy and we didn't want it to be a bad reflection on old Walt.
Very much.
God, Disney, you're doing something rude and Walt, you didn't want it to upset Walt. No. He's dead, you know.
We had a very healthy respect for Walt Disney. We felt...
There's actually a donkey in the Walt Disney film. There's actually a donkey in our video, but we didn't like
Walt. I see. Yes, thank you very much anyway. moving on, there's a donkey in both and there's a connection there. Somewhere. Yes, thank you very much anyway, ladies and gentlemen. Phil and Chris.
Is that it?
Cry. Yes.
thank you.
No, brilliant. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, yes, Annabelle there talking to Waterfront. Spies next, the old master himself, Miles Copeland, after this break.
You mean you've missed it? Every day at 11:30 on Sky? Well, let me tell you what you've missed. All the letters and all my answers. All my talks to Dr. David and all the fascinating facts and fabulous people who come along with Sue and Paul. Oh, and by the way, you've also missed David Steele, Katie Vora, John Fashanu, Nina Miskoff, Glyn Worson at Molly Parkin, to name but a few. Don't miss out anymore. Join me at 11:30 every day on Sky with a problem shared.
You little rabbit.
And so for tea, guess what they had?
Apple pie, like me.
Now you and Peter Rabbit be good bunnies and finish your tea. Well, Mopsy Rabbit and I do the washing up.
But rabbits don't wash up. They don't even like water.
Unless they've got soft, fluffy bubbles to help.
What bubbles? That stuff's washing up stuff.
Well, it's pretty good washing up stuff. Look how the bubbles get even this crusty old pie dish clean.
They're soft and fluffy.
That's why I like it. Helps keep my hands soft.
They feel like it's good for rabbits.
Why?
Because all rabbits should have soft faces. Soft. Like pudding. my mum's swimming suit.
They're still trying to describe a totally new kind of softness.
Little baby ducks like yellow. Well, I think it smells like sky to me.
The special softness you get with new Lenore.
Breastfeed again. Some ghosts.
Only Lenore can make your wash almost too soft for words.
If you use a cream to clean your bath, you know that what they leave behind can have you going round in circles, rinsing and rinsing again. But now, there's new Flash Cream. Look, we cleaned one half with an ordinary cream, the other with Flash. Rinse them down and they look the same, until you see what's left behind. New Flash Cream rinses more easily and wipes out dirt in a flash.
Jameson Tonight, Part 5. The most colourful character to come out of American intelligence and go public is a former jazz trumpeter turned master spy. For years now, he's been the ranking expert on his old paymasters, the CIA. And his fourth book on international espionage has just been published. It's called The Game Player. Here it is, gentlemen. That's the cameraman I'm talking about, yes. And here with us tonight, the man holding the cast, ladies and gentlemen, Miles Copeland. Welcome, Miles. You're just the man I want to talk to because, Miles, it's more than 30 years now since you were in the CIA and you've made an international industry of it since. Mm-hmm. Books, expert views, articles in the learned newspapers, television appearances.
What's he on about, isn't it?
Yes, yes?
Okay, you're on, yeah. We're
waiting.
Stay
that donkey, you know.
What I want to know, Miles, how much of this international espionage and spying is real and how much is it a kind of PR hype industry built up by the politicians and diplomats?
I'd say it's mostly built up by the politicians and, of course, by fellows like myself. there's a deplorable paucity of wickedness in the world.
Yeah, because it's a lot of posturing, isn't it?
It is indeed, and we have to invent much that really doesn't happen.
Of course,
we are not up to James Bond. There are no James Bonds, in case the audience expects there to be a James Bond popping out of the closet. They don't exist. Mostly, we're all sort of, we do as a con game what James Bond did physically in the pistols and his knuckles. Mm. And that's what it is. It's a lot of fun, mind you.
Yeah. Because it seems to me, a thick layman, that there are no great secrets left to spy on.
Not really, no. That's true. The spying business has really fallen off with these satellites flying around the world. And right now, I'd suppose that spying gets maybe 1% of the intelligence that eventually gets on the president's desk. But it does get a very vital percentage because these spy satellites can't read minds. Mm. And we have to get people inside the Kremlin who can tell us just what really is going on there. Yeah. And of course, we usually now, such spies as we have in the Soviet Union, you realize, of course, that all spies in the Soviet Union are Soviets, they're not Americans. Just as Kim Philby was a KGB agent, he was British. Burgess MacLean were British. If we have spies in Uruguay, they're Uruguayans. Well, in the Soviet Union, it's sort of hard on a man's nervous system to be a CIA spy for long. He tends to get ulcers, and we have to get him out, three years being about the maximum. And often they turn out just to be common defectors. Mm. And then, if they're high enough up in the government, they can tell us what's been going on behind the scenes in Glasnost and everything else. Fascinating.
And so it's really an inside track information, but nothing desperately exciting like James Bond.
Oh, no. I mean, the scientific secrets, the Soviets don't have anything to steal, but now KGB is an industry. It's cost effective. For example, if you figured out what they'd have to pay to get the intelligence on scientific inventions, everything medical to a military, it'd cost them billions of pounds a year. And believe me, in the cage in the Soviet Union, that's the best job you can get. In fact, if you were in the Soviet Union, you wouldn't be working here. You'd be working with the KGB because it's the best job you can get.
Indeed.
These guys are terrific.
And of course, you can get double wages because you can get paid as a KGB agent and paid to do your job.
Aha! Well, the KGB agent, they're usually known as KGB. No, they have it one way, which is enough for them.
Anyway, good days for the CIA, because the former head of the CIA is now the president of the United States.
That's been a step forward, and I have myself been involved in reorganizing the Central Intelligence Agency to make it an intelligence agency, because, you know, with these cowboys who were brought in from the Pentagon and whatever, we got into Central America and the silly business, which just almost ruined the agency. We had the tail wagging the dog from all the guys from... They're military types. They
and
don't see
desperate
it.
Mistakes they made.
Oh, colossal.
The plot against...
Amateurs.
What were their biggest mistakes, Miles? The plot against...
I think the biggest mistake is not to understand that we are set up to operate from the inside. For example, if they sent me to Nicaragua, and I don't speak Spanish, so they're not going to send me to Nicaragua. But if they did, we'd go to the Nicaraguan government. We would have people on the outside of the country. They're out for a good reason, after all. Mm. We'd go right to the leaders and say, look, what do you guys want? What do we want? It's very simple. We want you not to export your revolution. We want you to get rid of all these Russians, and we'll pay you for so doing. And if you want to sit here, if you want to, and we don't care whether you have free, we really don't care whether you have free elections and practice human rights. You can practice cannibalism if you want to, as long as you stay out of our hair. That's
as long as it's good for American interests.
Well, I know we Americans, as Americans, we understand human rights, but the CIA doesn't have that as their job. Their job is to see that these little governments around everywhere behave themselves in such a way that does not harm our interests, and incidentally helps their interests too.
Do they still consult you, Miles?
Oh, yeah. Sure.
What about the Lockerbie bomb? Who do you think was behind that?
Well, now, that is a very interesting question, because it's not as important as the police would like to make it out. These things become jurisdictional squabbles the minute they come up. Mm. You know, when you have a big government, you've had your solution first and your problem afterwards. In other words, when a problem arises, you adjust the problem so that you're the one that has a solution.
Got
now, in Lockerbie, it's a police problem so far as a policeman concerned. It's an intelligence problem so far as intelligence people concerned. Mm. They, frankly, hope that the investigation will fail. Does that shock you?
Yeah.
Well, no, let me explain. Because if they really do catch who did it and get him in court and win a few brownie points before the general public, it means that we blow our operations in which we're penetrating on the other side of the fence. We'd rather wrap up the whole thing. Yeah. We'd rather have a counter strategy in general and not have a victory in one case by case. But that's the difference in police intelligence agencies always. We're always each other's throats.
Yeah, and it's all a matter of wheeler-dealing, compromise, concessions?
Yes, but ordinarily it's usually mutual throat-cutting. I mean, compromise,
It's still a desperate business, yeah?
It still is, you know?
What I want to know is, Miles, where did you find these four brilliant children?
Isn't that nothing
to do with spying at all.
I
tell you, ladies and gentlemen,
right.
this man here, Miles Copeland, has got four sensational children.
Right.
One we had on the program the other day, that's Stuart Copeland, who was the co-presenter of the opera Carmen, and of course was a founder of Police, wasn't he, with Sting?
Was indeed.
Yeah.
Miles Copeland III actually manages Sting, doesn't he? He's a big impresario.
Along with 30 or 40 other people, he owns the record company, he owns all the family industries, he owns everything. Sting is one of his...
Yeah, what's the third son do?
He has the biggest independent booking agency in the world, in New York.
Oh, there you go. And your daughter, Lorraine?
She's a film producer. She's got more brains than all the rest of them put together.
Now, what I want to know, Copeland,
how about that, huh?
Now tell me the truth. Did you use your expertise and ability as a counterintelligence agent to land these four big jobs in the media? In other words, are they a chip off the old block?
Not quite. In fact, quite the opposite. In fact, when my oldest son was 21 years old, he decided that I wasn't managing the family finances properly, so he took them over. And he took joint accounts and all my bank accounts in New York, Beirut, wherever.
Good.
And he ran whatever we had. He quadrupled the family finances in just a short time. Then he went into the record business. He got some money out of Kuwaitis. He decided that why waste time getting money out of the Kuwaitis when pop groups are just as good. And so the first thing you know, he was in the pop music business, and now he has a record company, a film
company,
and the works.
There you go. Are you listening at home, my son? I hope my sons are listening to this, Miles.
I know.
Well,
quadrupled the family finances with the eldest son.
May I make
clever.
One suggestion? Yeah. What goes on in the classroom is not teaching. It's learning. And what you do, if you want to raise your children, is you don't teach them. You make them want to learn. And you put all the burden on them. and you give them a lot of reasons why they want to learn. You inspire them. You con them if you have to, as I did Stud. Well, Stud. We all joined in on that operation. And the first thing you know, they were all just breaking each other's neck in order to get ahead of each other. And my
Stud, the old American competition. Yeah. I told you it was a wily old fox. Ladies and gentlemen, Miles Copeland. That's it. There isn't any more. My thanks to all our wonderful guests tonight, Miles here and all the others, and of course our audience here at the Windmill and you at home. We'll be back ere long. That's Jameson tonight, 10:30. Tomorrow night, Sky Channel. I'll look out for you.
Topical chat and gregarious guests make up the Jameson Show again tomorrow night. On Sky News is NBC Nightly News, and we examine Australia's top end down under. Thursdays at 7:30. Tune in to
have more than $500,000 tucked away for retirement. The total so far, $39 million. They can use the money even if they leave in disgrace. Convicted of bribery, like Mario Biaggi. He spent it on his lawyers. Or if they're forced out under an ethical cloud, as